early in the morning of a lovely summer day, as they lowered the bright awning at the outdoor cafe, I was breakfasting on croissant and café au lait under greenery like scenery re François Premier. They were hosing the hot pavement with a dash of flashing spray, and the smell of summer showers when the dust is drenched away under greenery like scenery re François Premier. I was 20 and a lover, and in paradise to stay. Very early in the morning of a lovely summer
day. Pleasure of sitting with Andy Garland, professor at the University of Colorado here, and also fantastic recitalist and opera singer. You've been to the New York Festival of Songs many times to sing there, and you're going to be running a class on American songs.
American and British song literature.
English. Okay.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Fantastic. So we're going to do a Rorem song today, early in the morning. And what was your first encounter with Rorem?
Oh, I mean, everybody in my undergrad studio had a Rorem song or two. And I didn't take too many of his songs on until I was actually after grad school, now that I think of it. I was always aware of his songs, but I wasn't programming his songs. And I honestly don't know why. I was always admiring his songs. But then I had started programming some of his Walt Whitman settings in my professional recitals. I remember really enjoying singing A Look Down Fair Moon. But when I really took a deep dive into Rorem was almost 10 years ago, when the New York Festival of Song did a program called Ned is 90 for his 90th birthday in October of 2013.
Right.
And that program, a less creative title would have been Ned Rorem and Friends. We programmed some of Rorem's well-known and lesser-known songs, but also those of his contemporaries, his friends, and those who influenced him. So you had Samuel Barber, and you had Mark Blitzstein, but you also had Poulenc and Virgil Thompson.
That's awesome. That sounds like a great program. So I first met Rorem because Dan Kellogg, my husband, was a student of his. And so when we were dating during college, he would come up from Curtis to New York for his lessons. And that's how we got to see each other. And I remember Rorem gave me an autographed copy of his piano etudes. And I played the first one for my Tanglewood edition for Ursula Oppens. And she really liked them. So that's my first encounter. And then my second encounter is I was at the Ravinia Staines Institute. They were trying out this vocal program, and we premiered his Aftermath. There.
You played the premiere of Aftermath?
Yeah.
Ah!
Yeah. It was really cool. It was a great experience. But you know, he's very shy around women, so...
Yeah. Well, and I just wonder if he wasn't sort of keeping a sort of mystique, because the conversations I had with him were sort of very cryptic, but also made you think, like, what did he mean by that? Like, first, before I forget, it was maybe just a few years after you premiered Aftermath, the Staines Institute piloted a voice and strings program, And I sang the whole Santa Fe songs there at Staines.
Cool.
That's worth mentioning because that's a whole lot of Rorem.
Yeah, that's cool.
It's like 25 minutes of really good Rorem.
That's awesome.
And they told it when we were there. Margot Garrett was still the head of that program, and she told us all about how you all premiered Aftermath there and how, I think, Ned, if I'm not mistaken, he was commissioned to do a work for voice and strings and piano. And then 9/11 happened, and he scrapped that and then picked all new poetry and a new theme.
Right, yeah. Right, so the last time I saw him, I think it was like backstage at a concert at Carnegie. And it's been a while, but we mourn his passing recently, and he definitely had such a great output. So, all right, let's get into like the meat of interpretation here.
Okay.
Tell me about some of the things that were going in your mind, trying out this acoustic and trying out, I don't know, different ways that we can bring out different lines.
Well, whatever the song, no matter what it is, if it's a good song, and I try to only do good songs, and this is a great song, but whatever the song is, I want to sing legato, and I want it to sound like recognizable English.
Okay.
And you might, and those two things might seem opposed to each other, but they're not. And so that's sort of my basic first priorities. And so I hope in the recording you hear that you at least hear that. Mm-hmm. Then beyond that, I might think, okay, what is the feeling and how does that translate into classical singing? Mm-hmm. And so in our rehearsal here, we talked a lot about what colors do we want here and so forth. Mm-hmm. So one spot where I think we indulge a lot, and I think it is justified, just towards the end when he says, I was 20 and a lover and in paradise to stay. And not only do we take some time to say all of that, but I think the color becomes very wistful. You might describe it as warm, but also it's a wistful feeling and might result in kind of sort of a breathy texture. A warm feeling and a breathy texture. You know, you can do both of those at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you can judge for yourself when you listen.
Yeah.
But we took the time to say that, too.
Right, that's really cool. Yeah, one line of tension in this piece is he's reminiscing about something that is very distant and he can't be there anymore. But then the rest of the song, it starts out being like, I feel like he's right there. He's eating that croissant and it's very present. To him, so it's interesting how we show the difference of the time span, and then the other part is just like this luxurious laziness. I feel like there's like a lot of places where like he's happy doing nothing.
Yes,
and sometimes that's really hard to show. So yeah, I don't know if you show it more with. Like when you think about the being and the like the not efforting, are you thinking about more like spaciousness, or are you thinking maybe more about muscle engagement?
You know, the parallels might be more immediate than you think, because good vocal technique, not unlike good piano technique, involves isolating and not activating whole muscle groups. We were talking even earlier about how you never need to, you know, tense the back of the muscles in the back of your neck, right? Mm-hmm. And if you breathe in a perfect, you know, inhale for singing, like ideally, it never happens this way, but ideally it's silent. Right there. And so if I'm gonna, I could be very ecstatic about this memory and say, early in the morning of a lovely summer day. But if I'm more serene, I might sing.
Early in the morning of a lovely summer day.
There, I've just put less muscular effort, but all the same sort of mental, I don't want to say energy and excitement, but I mean...
intensity?
Yeah, there is a different intensity to that.
Mm-hmm.
It's more of just feeling good about feeling good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you can't avoid meta feelings. How would I encapsulate that in one statement? Yes, you do need the energy to produce the sound, but then the tone and the texture of that sound can then make the listener feel the calm. Does that work?
Mm-hmm.
Make sense?
Sure. Yeah. Okay, now you said something really interesting earlier about you wanted to be more clear by having more overtones.
Yeah. If you ever listen to yourself on a voicemail, if you ever still do voicemail, if you hear a recording of yourself, you know you sound very different to yourself inside your own head than everyone else hears you. And a constant struggle for singers is to produce the most sort of audible, resonant, clear sound for the audience, but not the warmest, biggest sound that they hear in their own head. So if I go and sing what sounds like a very present sound to myself, taking the opening phrase again, for example, which isn't particularly operatic, but it does need to resonate unamplified in a space. What might sound to me as very big and round, excuse me, early in the morning, sorry, excuse me, I'll try that again.
Early in the morning of a lovely summer day.
That sounds very big to me, but now if I do this.
Early in the morning of a lovely summer day.
Could you hear a difference there?
Yeah, it's projecting outward.
It is projecting outward, exactly. In that first song, I was deliberately, although many of us do this not deliberately, pulling my tongue in the back of my throat. Not to get too technical, but that makes you feel like you're producing tone, and it makes sound that reverberates in your own head. But then if you just relax the back of the tongue, get it out of the space, one, you don't feel anything going on here. So it feels like you're not doing anything.
Mm-hmm.
It's just space there. Mm-hmm. And that space creates space to resonate. And so what I think it was, well, a lot of singers and teachers of singers and people who talk intelligently about singing will say, voices don't project, they resonate. Now, of course, you can of course use the word project, but if I, as the person who's doing the singing, if I think of that as resonating, it will then, the effect will be that it projects.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Awesome.
Is that enough to say about overtones?
I think so. It's really cool. Because, I mean, with the piano, I think I would produce more overtones by having more support in the bass.
Uh-huh. And
that's pretty much the only thing I can do to, like, create overtones. But with the less efforting, the muscle engagement portion of it, I can get different colors. There's different notes. Like, we were talking about the leading tone.
Oh, yeah.
Where I just feel like it's a brighter vowel. And I'm thinking about vowels and consonants because of all your words. But, like, here... terms of, like, just different colors of the consonants that you are singing, but it's not actually part of the words that you're doing at the moment. But it definitely gets me into a different headspace when I'm hearing all your words and how that's shaping your decisions. Yeah. Oh, that high note. That was a really fun, the high F.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That is
how
not...
How do you make that work?
I don't know. No. In my warm-ups, I need to remind myself how to sing that with no excess pressure. It's really easy, especially if you're making a classical operatic tone. That is something that was round with an open throat. That by contrast, say, I, not to get too into evolution and anthropology, if someone was to be loud up in that frequency, that cry might be something more like, "Oh, oh no, oh." For whatever reason, distress, or just simply to need to call over a long distance, I think it's a bit contrived to then open your throat and tilt your larynx down, like I'm doing now, and then go all the way up. Oh, right. That takes a bit of training, but also to not do the following. Oh, right there. You can see that wasn't as loud. I was putting way too much pressure on that. Smell of summer showers when the dust is drenched away.
Drenched.
Right.
Dust is drenched away.
I need just a little bit of time to vibrate each one of those eighth notes. And so one of my favorite coaches, Sylvia Tibby Plyler at Cincinnati College Conservatory of Music, she paraphrased Orwell when she said, "All eighth notes are created equal. However, some eighth notes are more equal than others." And there's a prime example of that eighth note, the shortest note that, you know, that I have in this. It needs to be much longer than an exact eighth note, so I can vibrate through those and do the consonants that are on either side of those.
Yeah, a lot happening.
And so I very much appreciate your going along with that as is necessary. Just like if you had a very large leap or a very awkward chord change there that requires time to move the fingers,
yeah,
I would, of course, wait for that.
Yeah.
And sometimes I can tell if it's a new piece. I can tell if that's in the piano, but usually the pianist has to say, "Hey, I need time to do this." And I.
But then even when I don't need time, there are places where it's just more fun, because like he's writing a bigger interval for an expressive reason, like when you do the smell of summer.
Yes.
That whole leap of an octave, it wants more time.
Yes.
Yeah. Cool. Well, great. Thank you.
Thank you.